We have the Vice President of Engineering for Google, who's coming to give us a higher order bit. And I'll just give you the title of it. It's definitely related to what we just heard from Niall. The Programmable Web. Jeff Huber.
Sorry.
Welcome.
Thanks. Hi, as John mentioned, I'm Jeff Huber, VP of Engineering at Google, where I'm responsible for our advertising products, including AdWords and AdSense, as well as Google Apps, things like Gmail, Calendar, Docs, and Orkut.com. But I'm not here today to talk about any of those things directly. I'm here to talk about a small topic, but one that we think has big implications, specifically gadgets. Niall Kennedy was introduced earlier as the king of widgets, so maybe I'll be the prince of gadgets for the next few minutes. Getting some slides in place, but maybe I'll jump into gadgets themselves or widgets or mini applications, depending on your particular religion. Are small applications or chunks of functionality that are created by users or developers with simple technologies like HTML, RSS, AJAX, and Flash, use APIs like our GData APIs or those provided by other folks, including Yahoo, Microsoft, eBay, Facebook, and others, and are embedded in sites across the web, homepages, blogs, commercial sites, social networks, et cetera, and in the last while are being socially distributed, whether it's via ranking, sharing, or invites. The nice thing about this gadget model is it's open, easy, mashable, hackable in a good way. It's a model that disaggregates and extends the web in very useful ways. So if you sprinkle in some monetization, and Niall went through some examples earlier of gadget ads. So via gadget ads, via monetization or ads within the gadgets, or things like pixel share, you have what some people are starting to call the gadget ecosystem. Whatever you call it, it is big and is growing fast and getting there very quickly. And per the title of the talk, it might just be the atomic building block of what we collectively are looking at as the programmable web, and ultimately is significant as things like HTML, RSS, and AJAX before them. So in the remaining 6 or 7 minutes, I'll do a run through how we got here, Web 2.0 today, some stats from our slice of this gadget ecosystem, as well as a prognostication or two thrown in. And as part of that, let me just take a look at this for some. This might look like the million-dollar homepage, but it's actually a collage of over 10,000 gadgets that run on in the Google ecosystem today. This is less than half of the total number, over 20,000 gadgets that are available, running on over 100,000 sites across the web. So we've already seen one wave of development that enabled regular people to do amazing things with content on the web. And it was really about disaggregation of content and the extension of content, where it provided content providers the ability to syndicate their content via feeds, or for you to do things like put a video on your blog and then syndicate your blog to other places. It enabled things like this, which is kind of iGoogle 1.0, or things like Google Reader for the more voracious feed readers among you. Or obviously things like My Yahoo and other customized start pages. The next phase is really about the disaggregation of applications and disaggregation and extension of applications. Instead of applications being stuck at a single URL or being stuck in your desktop, they live in the cloud, they're embeddable and portable to any location. So what RSS did for content, gadgets now are doing for applications. The screenshot here is from the second generation of iGoogle and has basically lets me syndicate utility instead of just syndicating content like previously. So this has my email, my budget, my commute in the morning in one place. But people are actually taking this a step further, which is the disaggregation of applications and the re-aggregation of applications in totally new ways. And actually making them talk to each other. So apps are now spreadable and portable, but the real fun is when you start doing things in new ways, putting them together on top of each other, inside each other, without having to start from the ground up each time you want to do that. So here's an example of gadgets being embedded in Google Maps. Across Google, just about every one of our current products is becoming a container for gadgets. So you can see them in places like Blogger, Page Creator, and Orkut. Across the web, you see this with the emergence of things like Slide and RockYou, going back to the panel discussion earlier, merging on MySpace and Facebook, albeit with varying degrees of openness and access to the underlying resource. But the net on this is that this model enables cool functionality for you, the user, meeting highly relevant context that you choose. So here are a few applications. Niall already touched on one of these, but on the left is a Google Talk gadget, which is a real-time multi-user chat embeddable anywhere across the web. On the right is an application that lets you schedule meetings, pick locations, and coordinate with your friends, in this case provided as an application by Starbucks, so they hope to charm you out of your the next $5 Frappuccino. And the one in the center is an application that's an ad, a gadget ad, in this case done by Honda and the band Fall Out Boy together, where it's a user-selected ad that can be embedded anywhere across the web. So it really changes the historical perception of what advertising is. So given this, there are many roles that you can play in this new ecosystem. There's creative opportunities, content distribution, interesting technical challenges, advertising opportunities, money-making opportunities. And across this, you'll see a lot of different kinds of gadgets, social gadgets, business gadgets, content gadgets, productivity gadgets, in addition to cow throwing and food fighting gadgets, some of which were also in the panel discussion this morning. But this is a relatively new model. You could be skeptical and say, yeah, those are cute, but is anybody really using them? So why don't we pour some data on it? So this first graph is pretty simple. The shape of the graph is nice. It shows a number of gadgets over time, and these are specifically in the Google's corner of the ecosystem. Adding some more data to it, from time T0 in January 06, we now have over 20,000 gadgets that are out there. So the question is where? So yes, some of them are on Google properties like iGoogle, which is growing very rapidly, and some of the other containers I mentioned. But they're also syndicated across the web. So there's over 100,000 sites across the web that are using this gadget model. And in aggregate, serving over billions of gadgets every week. So what's interesting about this is, as an individual company, we never would have been able to grow this quickly. It's really the power of an open development platform and an open distribution system that it's enabling it. Some more data. This looks at the number of users and who's using these things. You can see it's a somewhat classic long-tail distribution. Clip the sides just to make it more readable. But the very top apps have more than tens of millions of users. Extending that a bit further, there's over 60 applications that have over a million seven-day active users. Going down the curve, nearly 500 that have more than 100,000 seven-day active users. And when you look at the tail, about more than half of the traffic is outside of the top 125. So the good news for this is with this open distribution model, it's no longer as critical to be one of the very top people. There's an untapped opportunity for you as a small team to reach new users or as a business to reach your passionate users directly. So, turning then to more profound thoughts. Cue the 2001 theme. We think that this is really quite significant. This is a dramatic image, but what we see is applications fundamentally changing. Just like the model for content changed, now the model for applications is changing from monolithic sites to instead being smaller feeds and containers. This takes advantage of a new open distribution channel that we were using for content, now being used for applications. You see this extending beyond the consumer side as well, where enterprise is starting to take notice with people like IBM, Red Hat, BEA, and Sun jumping on. So what we have now is an open ecosystem that's very democratic and fast-moving and at the point of being self-sustaining. We can already see that the foundation is there for this, and even if we can't exactly today predict how it's going to evolve, like those mammals after the asteroid. So another thing that you've heard a lot about at Web 2.0 this round is about platforms. And there's still a lot of conversation about, quote, winning the platform. And I guess our view on that is that's going back to the dinosaur, roughly Paleolithic thinking, that the platform race is over. The internet has already won. The web is the platform. And we as an industry are finally catching up and recognizing this opportunity. The platform is a mosaic of gadgets and APIs and containers all over the web. It enables development, innovation, utility in all new ways. So back to the title of the talk, let's do it. Let's go build the programmable web. It's easy, open, and fast. And to develop, to distribute, to adopt, and it should be a lot of fun. Thank you.